please.
Yeah, thank you. So since it's the last talk, first I would like to that we all thank Lorenzo, Sueli, the organizers, IMPA, for the 2 days. So thank you. So to start, I would like to share with you three memories I have about the beginning of my when I start in Dynamics, and about Jaco. So the first one is occurred 20 years ago. It was Jaco's 60th birthday here, and for me it was the first time in Brazil and at IMPA. I was a student, and it was like a shock to see many, many topics discussed in that conference. I learned a lot. I saw many main actors of dynamical systems, so it was really important for me. And also, I saw that in Brazil there is a huge family in Dynamics, very friendly, and so it was also very nice. But it was not the first time I met Jaco, since I was student of Jean-Christophe Yokoz, and they were working together. So Jaco came to Paris quite frequently, and so I met him in Jean-Christophe's office. And so he was always giving nice words and encouragement. At the time, they were working on that work that Enrique presented about non-uniformly hyperbolic horseshoes. So I was following Jean-Christophe courses during 2 years about that work. And well, it was very difficult for me as a student to understand in detail that, but I learned a lot. In fact, the links between IMPA, France, Brazil, and especially thanks to Jaco, were and are strong. So not only because of Jean-Christophe, but because of other people in France who came here, had the chance here to come and to be welcome here, and also with their cause, for instance, Christian Bonatti, which is a co-author of mine. And the third memory is, so after my PhD, I started to learn more about other things done by Jaco, so not about theorems, but about conjectures. So he had this paper where he proposed a very deep vision of dynamical system. And it took me time to digest what he was proposing. And so this is what I would like to talk about today. Well, I will start about slowly about some historical things and that you know well, but okay. So what is the goal in differentiable dynamics? So we have a system here, closed manifold and transformation, diffeomorphism, and the goal is to describe the orbits. And for a long time we know that it's there is no way in general, so we won't describe all orbits, but we want to describe most of the orbits in some sense, and later on even rely that we can't do that for any system, so maybe it's possible anyway to have it for a large class of system, for most system, but we have to precise what most mean. Well, so there were examples that emerge and that guide the beginning of differentiable dynamics. So, for instance, Morse-Mail system, the simplest one, the dynamic sits on finitely many periodic points. But at the same time, Anosov realized that there are systems where the orbits are dense. So Anosov map on the torus here. And then Smale discovered his horseshoe. So here the dynamics sits on a complicated set. It's a counter set. Dynamics is rich, but it's not the whole manifold. And there also exists a non-trivial attractor, for instance, the Pekin attractor. All these examples are structurally stable, meaning that if you perturb the system, even if the dynamics is very complicated, the dynamics remain unchanged. And so it was a hope that structurally stable system maybe are dense in the whole space of dynamical system. To put all the system in the same box, we have to introduce a notion of hyperbolicity. So you know, an invariant compact set is hyperbolic if its tangent dynamics decompose in two parts, one contracted, one expanded. And then I like this way to define hyperbolic map. A hyperbolic map is a map which admits a filtration, so that in each level of the filtration, the invariant set is a hyperbolic set. And there's system have many nice properties. I mentioned the stability, but you also have a finite decomposition. You can code, you can find finitely many physical measures, etc. I'd like to say also to focus on two things that are important for the system. So about the stability, you may wonder if there are other stable system, and Smale and Pallis conjecture that no, and this was a big adventure in dynamics to check that conjecture for C1 topology, which culminated with the work of Manier. Nevertheless, hyperbolic system and stable system are not dense, so you need to address also other kind of dynamics. But you may use hyperbolic systems as a simplest version, a simplest model for some more complicated system. So you use them as a guide. So why the system are not dense in the whole set of dynamics? That's because there are obstructions, which were found quite early by Abraham Smale and a new house. And so there are two simple obstructions. One comes from heterodimensional cycles. So here, there are two periodic points, things, two fixed points, for instance, which are hyperbolic. So they have a stable and unstable manifold, which intersect. So these two points are linked by the dynamics. But anyway, their stable dimensions do not coincide, so they can't belong to a same hyperbolic set. And the other obstruction are the homoclinic tangencies. So here you have a single periodic point with a stable and stable manifold, which have a point of tangency. So if you decompose the dynamics by a filtration, the point of tangency should should belong to one of the levels of the filtration, but you can't. This level cannot be hyperbolic because of the tangency. At the tangency, there is no way to define a hyperbolic splitting. And the homoclinic tangency are source of a very amazing phenomena. So discovered by Newhouse, when you unfold the tangency, it generates things, and in fact, you infinitely many things, and not just for exceptional system, but for large set of systems. Okay, so you have to work with that. So what to do? And so that's where the conjecture entered. And so Jaco proposed conjecture in several waves. So I found it first in the proceedings of a conference in Nagoya. And then there are several papers. Here I've extracted some part of the conjecture, but they are discussed a lot in these papers. So I put three parts. So the first part says, okay, there are systems that are non-uniformly hyperbolic, that are not uniformly hyperbolic, but maybe you can anyway find some that share some property with hyperbolic ones. So we call them non-uniformly hyperbolic system, meaning that they have a finite number of attractors and good physical measure on them and some weak stability. And the conjecture said that, well, this system maybe are not the majority, but there is a dense set of the system in the whole space of dynamics. The second one explain what are the obstructions for hyperbolicity, how to characterize a lack of uniform hyperbolicity. Well, we saw two obstructions, and it said that there are the only one. There are enough to characterize a lack of hyperbolicity. And the last one, in the same spirit, so is linked to Newhouse phenomenon. So I said, when you pass a tangency, you get infinitely many things. That's what we call the Newhouse domain, wild behavior. And the conjecture proposed that, in fact, wild behavior always comes from homotonic tangencies. And these conjectures were very important for the topic because they motivated many works in our community since more than 25 years. So today I would like to talk about the second one and comment more about that. So we have hyperbolic system, we have systems that are not hyperbolic, and we would like to characterize those that are not hyperbolic to see in a simple way to detect the lack of hyperbolicity. And as a consequence of the work on the structural stability conjecture by Manier, improved by Hayashi, there is this result that any diffeomorphism either can be approximated by a uniformly hyperbolic one or by one which has a non-hyperbolic periodic point. So having a non-hyperbolic periodic point is very simple configuration that comes once you don't have hyperbolicity. So in some sense, it characterizes the lack of uniform hyperbolicity. But it doesn't tell you much about the dynamics. You just have a periodic point. You don't know what happens once you perturb. You don't know what happens in the neighborhood of the periodic point. So Jacot's conjecture proposes a different characterization. He proposed that if you can't approximate by uniformly hyperbolic one, then that's because you can approximate by a homoclinic bifurcation, so either a heterotangential cycle or a homoclinic tangency, which gives you more information. Why? Because when you pass when you unfold the cycle or the tangency, then you create or you destroy a lot of dynamics. In particular, you reproduce the homoclinic bifurcation. So if you have a homoclinic tangency, then you will have many ones in a neighborhood. That's why you will get there's infinite number of things. Moreover, whereas a non-hyperbolic periodic point can always be removed by transversality, there's homoclinic bifurcation can be made robust. So again, having a homoclinic bifurcation is something of codimension one. So what does it mean to make it robust? So for instance, for the tangency, instead to look at just a fixed point or a periodic point, you may look at a larger hyperbolic set, a horseshoe, look to the stable lamination and unstable lamination. Then for each pair of leaves, you may have a tangency that you can destroy. But since you have lamination, Sometimes, and that's what happened in Newhouse work, you can never remove all the tangencies at the same time. So having a tangency is robust, and you have the same something similar with the heterodimensional cycle. Yes, in particular thanks to Blender, as Lorenzo and Christian did. Okay. And so with Enrique, we like to present this kind of conjecture, to restate it in a perspective that can be applied to other dichotomies. So we say that there is a dichotomy by phenomena and mechanisms. So on one side, the phenomena, you have a dynamics with that you can describe in some sense globally. So for the hyperbolicity, for instance. On the other side, you have a mechanism. So the mechanism don't give you a global information. It's semi-local. But anyway, it has there's a strong consequences that I have described. You have other example of such dichotomies, like having zero entropy and homoclinic intersection, for instance. So this is a conjecture. And now I'd like to discuss what is known about it. So there are, in Lau dimension, you have a stronger structure, and it's possible to show, to get something in that direction. There are very precise results, very strong result. I think about one-dimensional dynamics for endomorphism. So it's not for diffeomorphism, so which has been developed successfully. So, but today I like to talk about diffeomorphism and even in higher dimension. And so in higher dimension, this becomes very difficult to be able to say something about any diffeomorphism. So the only way today to be able to say something like that is to work with the C1 topology. So let me discuss what we know with the C1 topology. So once again, we want to describe any diffeomorphism at first, or to start with any diffeomorphism. So what do we know about any diffeomorphism? Well, there are very general descriptions. A way to study the dynamics is first to decompose it. So there is a way to decompose it, which applies always, into invariant set, invariant compact set, disjoint, that are called chain recurrent classes that I won't define. You may think, if you want, that they are maximal transitive set, but it's something weaker. And a way to say that a diffeomorphism is hyperbolic is to say that each chain recurrent class is hyperbolic. In general, the chain recurrent class could be quite wide. There could be infinitely many ones. When it's hyperbolic, you only have finitely many ones. But your initial diffeomorphism is arbitrary. And then the tools, the important tools, which comes from the C1 topology, so you allow C1 perturbation, which are quite flexible, are the perturbation lemma, which first started with Pu, so with the closing lemma, which allow by perturbation to create periodic orbit, then Hayashi connecting lemma, which allow to connect stable and unstable manifold, and then the closing and connecting lemmas for pseudo orbit that I developed with Christian, and which allow to work with chain recurrent classes. And now I give the consequence that we have. So it allows to say something for C1 generic diffeomorphism. What do we know about chain recurrent classes? First, they are always approximated by periodic orbits. And then you may always divide the classes in two categories, those that contain periodic points, those that do not. So if they do not, you call them aperiodic classes. So you just know that there are limits of periodic points, but you don't know much about what you have inside, was once you contain just one periodic orbit, then the class is a homoclinic class, meaning that it coincides with the, so the periodic orbit has to be hyperbolic, and the class coincides with the transverse intersection, the closure of the transverse intersection point of the stable and unstable manifold. The closure is missing. And as a consequence, just having one periodic orbit implies that you have a dense set of periodic points in the class, which is a key point for studying the homoclinic class. Okay, so now let's see what we know about the conjecture. So in dimension one, for diffeomorphism, we understand very well the dynamics. For an open and dense subset of system, the dynamics is more small. That's the end of the story. So what about dimension two? And so Enrique Pujals and Martin Sambarino have proved that on surfaces, the conjecture holds in a C1 topology, but you in dimension two, there is no heterodimensional cycle. So any diffeomorphism can be perturbed by one which is hyperbolic or by one which has a homoclinic tangency. So this is a work that appeared in 2000, so at the same time as the first conferences, the 60th birthday conference. So later I worked with Enrique, and we got a result in any dimension, but which didn't conclude completely the conjecture. So it said that, so for any manifold, any diffeomorphism can be either perturbed by one which exhibit a homoclinic bifurcation, or by one which is almost hyperbolic. We call it essentially hyperbolic, meaning that for such system, in an open set, you can't not distinguish it with a hyperbolic system. So there exist finitely many hyperbolic attractors, hyperbolic repellers, and for a dense set of orbit, you come from such a repeller and ends in an attractor. So maybe there are exceptional exotic classes in the middle that you don't understand. And so this, we had a preprint in 2010. And so now we are in 2020, and I'd like to present a new result. So in dimension three, with Enrique, we proved the conjecture, so still in dimension, for the C1 topology. So this time, we understand the dynamics even outside the attractors and the repellers. So this is what I'd like to explain now. So of course, it's the continuation of a long story. So I will begin by recalling the results that were developed before and that were used in the two first results. So this is our goal. What we will do is, since we want to have a result for a dense set, C1 dense set of diffeomorphism, we will take a diffeomorphism which is C1 generic, so it belongs to a dense J delta set that is nicely chosen. We will assume that it is far from homoclinic bifurcation, and we have to show that it is hyperbolic. So to do that, we have to show that each chain recurrent class is hyperbolic. There are two kinds of chain recurrent class. Well, I won't discuss about the aperiodic classes. I will concentrate on the homoclinic one. So we take a homoclinic class, we have to show that it's hyperbolic, assuming that we are far from homoclinic bifurcation. So what we knew before, and I will recall, are these properties. So we have some partial hyperbolicity on the homoclinic class, and then we have special geometry inside the class when you study the strong foliations associated to the partial hyperbolicity, so the strong stable and the strong unstable, which are strong connections. So strong connection means, for instance, that you have a strong stable leaf associated to a point of the class which meets the class again at other points, at least one other point. And what to do? So this is what we knew, and what we have to do is to say, okay, we have strong connection, but we want a strong connection which has a better property, which is associated to a periodic point, P here. Okay, so you have a periodic point P, its strong stable manifold meets the class, what to do? Yes, somewhere else. Then using connecting lemmas, you can send the unstable manifold of P near this point, take an intersection, and so you have this special configuration, and then you can forget the class. So you have the strong stable and the unstable which intersect. So this is what we can do once you have a strong connection associated to P. And then we say, okay, let's assume that the class is not hyperbolic, that it fails. Then, in fact, this periodic point here, you can choose it well so that it detects the lack of hyperbolicity. So the you have a weakest direction with a very weak contraction, and so you can bifurcate that point and create three periodic point clause and keep track of the configuration you had so that the unstable manifold of one intersects the stable manifold of the second one. But these two ones that you have now don't have the same behavior in the weak direction. One expands, the other one contracts. So they don't have the same stable dimension. And so what you have obtained is a heterodimensional cycle. So if the class is not hyperbolic, you have a cycle. You assume it was not the case. You find your contradiction. So the class is hyperbolic. OK? So I will. What I will do now is to explain a bit these properties and then explain how we do to find a strong connection at a periodic point. Okay, so let me summarize a lot of work. So I put some names. So again, you have a C1 generic diffeomorphism. You have a homoclinic class. Let's assume it's not just a periodic orbit. And you use the information that you are far from homoclinic tangencies. So first, from homoclinic bifurcation. So first, the tangencies. Well, if you have a periodic orbit, it's hyperbolic. You have a stable direction and unstable direction. Maybe by perturbation, you can move that direction, make the angle small. And when the angle is small, get a tangency. You assume you're far from tangencies. It's not possible. So when you perturb, the splitting at the periodic point remains good. And since you're in a homoclinic class, periodic points are dense. You have a good splitting on a dense set. You can pass to the closure and get a splitting on the whole class. You can do that for different kind of periodic points, and so find different splitting which all together give you such a splitting on the class, so which we call dominated splitting. So you have several invariant bundles. In the middle, the bundles are one-dimensional, and the extremal one are uniform. So here you have one which is contracted and one which is expanded. Maybe they don't exist. In this case, in the middle, you only have one-dimensional bundle. So this is what we know when we are far from tangency. Let's use the fact that we are far from cycles now. Well, if you have a lot of center bundle, then in the class, this implies that you will have periodic points with different stable dimension. Since they are in the same class, you can link them together and create a cycle, and you assume it's not the case. So far from cycles imply that you can at most have two center bundles, and even you can recover a weak hyperbolicity along them that we call chain hyperbolicity. So you may think that along the first one, your chain stable, meaning that instead to be contracted by the map, you're contracted in the sense of pseudo-orbit of chains. I won't define, but it's useful information. Okay, and then I said maybe you have extremal bundles that are degenerated, and so this is a last information which say that in fact no, this bundle have to be non-trivial. So this comes from an initial work in dimension one by Manier, and then the work of Enrique and Martin on surfaces, which concluded the hyperbolicity. Okay, so if you put all that together, what you conclude is that you have a partial hyperbolicity, and in dimension three, you can't have two center bundles at the same time plus two extremal bundles. So you have at most one center bundle, and so if the class is not hyperbolic, you have these three bundles. For the center one, it may be chain contracted or chain expanded. So let's assume it's chain contracted. And that's what we have to work with now. And then I introduce a second tool, which is a special configuration I already mentioned, which are strong connections. So let me say again, now that we are partially hyperbolic, there are two laminations, the strong stable one, the strong unstable one. It's not symmetric now, the situation, since the center is assumed to be chain stable. So we will consider the first bundle. So we have the strong stable lamination, and we look for strong connections, meaning that we look for a pair of points, distinct points in the class, that share a same strong stable leaf. We want to use this configuration. And in a result with Christian Bonatti, we prove that if this strong connection does not occur, what does it mean? It means that if you look to the class looking in the strong stable direction, you always see at most one point, and so the class is like a graph when you look in the strong stable direction. And indeed, you can perform a center manifold argument, and in this case, conclude that the class is contained in a submanifold transverse to the strong stable. So what happened? You have a submanifold, which is also, I didn't write, is locally invariant. So you have reduced the dimension of your system, and you have killed the first bundle. So now, in restriction, you only have this decomposition, and I told you that the extremal bundles have to be uniform. So the first one has to be uniformly contracted, and that's what you wanted. The class is hyperbolic. So we are reduced to the case where there always exists a strong connection. And as I said, this is useful, but what we can conclude and get contradiction by building a heterodimensional cycle, provided this strong connection is associated to a periodic point. So this is what we have to do now. We have to find, to start with a strong connection and find in some way a periodic strong connection, so meaning another strong connection associated to a periodic point. So this is what we did in that new work. So let me explain, starting with a very simple argument to get that. So we start, so again, here is the splitting we have on the class. We start with a strong connection associated to two points x, y. Well, we have enough weak hyperbolicity so that we have kind of product structure which allows to build another point in the unstable manifold, let's say, of y, point z, and even to get a point z whose distance to y is comparable to the distance between x and y. So we have three points that are almost the corners of a square. So here, these are the unstable. Here you have the strong stable lines, and the third direction is given by the center. So the center here doesn't play, but in fact, when you follow these curves, strong curves, when you come here, it doesn't, a priori, doesn't match with the strong and stable of x. So you have this situation. And then you perturb. How do you perturb? You consider x, you consider the plane given by the center and the unstable, and you rotate so that you try to move the unstable manifold here so that here on the picture it's above the Strong's table of Z, and rotating it would go below, like that. So let's assume you can perturb to do that. Okay, what happens during the perturbation? Well, since you're in a homoclinic class, you have a dense set of periodic points. So there is one periodic point close to Z. And at the time you perturb, for one of these periodic points, its strong stable manifold will meet the unstable manifold of X. And a point now, the intersection will be homoclinic between X and P, so belongs to the class. And so you found a periodic point whose strong stable meet the class at another point. It's a strong connection, and that's what you wanted. So perfect. So you have a very simple way to get periodic strong connection. The problem with this argument is that when you perturb, you don't have a good control on this point. This point moves a bit. So usually in the hyperbolic setting, when you perturb, you have a continuation of point. You have shadowing lemma, which say that the point don't move too much. Here you have a lack of hyperbolicity in principle in the center, and so the point cannot escape in the strong direction, but in the center they can move a lot. And so maybe during the perturbation, the point escape in the center, like that. And they escape outside the domain where you control the rotation of the manifold, and you lose the control. The point really may escape a lot, and okay. So you have to find a way to control that. And the way we do it is to consider barriers. So let's assume we have the following situation. So still, you have a strong connection here. And for that point, you have the unstable but in the center, and so you have the center unstable plane. That is, let's assume it's foliated by strong unstable, by the unstable. And so if you are at a very small scale, everything is almost linear, but let's assume that the leaves here, the strong and stable leaves, are twisted a bit compared to reference linear direction, so that if you move in the center, you first meet leaves that are twisted below, and then above, and then below again, like that. If for some reason you have such information on the strong and on the unstable foliation, then you repeat your perturbation. The point, assume the point moves in the center, and then what happens is the following. So assume you have two points that start below. So maybe the strong unstable of the, I didn't put X, Y, Z. So the strong stable of Z is below the unstable of X. And then during the perturbation, the two points move up. So one thing is that the strong connection for X and Y cannot be destroyed. So these points move together up. Then they will, at some point, reach the second barrier where the twisting is in the other direction. And then what changes is that now, for the new point Z, the strong stable is above the unstable of X. Before it was below, now it's above. And even when the points continue to move, then again it reaches the last barrier and it's below. So you have an oscillation and you change the configuration. And so in the middle, something should cross. And so if you remember that there is a periodic point here that follows that point Z, this periodic point has a strong stable which at some moment during the movement has to reach the unstable manifold of X and again give a strong connection, so this is perfect. Okay, so this is perfect if you have this barrier, but you need to build them. So how to build them? Well, so you say, okay, I will twist here, I will twist here, I will twist here, so I will perturb. But as before, if I perturb, if I twist, my strong connection here during the time I perturb may escape, go somewhere else, and I lose the control. So what to do? What to do is to perturb a priori. So we don't consider the strong connection for the moment, And we just need to fill the class with barrier. So I didn't know how to picture, so I have a very impressionist drawing. So we fill the class by disjoint boxes at a small scale. And in each class, in each box, we twist either above and below, so that now when you have a center curve, it will meet alternatively boxes where I twist up and where we have twisted down and up again. So you can do that. You need to tile in a proper way. So you do that. Once you have tiled, you consider a strong connection. You don't know at first. You have tiled everywhere, so the strong connection appeared somewhere. And then you twist the center unstable at the point X to create your periodic strong connection. Either you get it, or the 2 point escape, but during the time they escape, they will cross these boxes, which are barrier, and produce, in another way, the strong connection. So you see, you have a quite geometrical way to get this, to conclude the existence of heterodimensional cycle and to get the theorem I have presented before. So we were very happy to have that, and we want to dedicate it to Jaco and give it as a gift for his birthday. So again, Jaco was a huge source of inspiration, and so thank to him again, and happy birthday to him again.
Comments or questions?